Again, a very good evening, a very good afternoon, and a very good morning to all our viewers, of course, across the world, and especially for those here present at the BMICH and are present here live at the International Symposium on Multi-Hazard Early Warning and Disaster Risk Reduction, which is held here in Sri Lanka, of course, throughout the course of the past 2.5 days. We are now entering the final plenary session of this international symposium. I would be right to dub this as the most important session, of course, of this international symposium. As the saying goes, we do save the best for last. And of course, this final plenary session will lead to the adoption of the Colombo Declaration, which is expected to promote the availability and application of research science and technology to support the implementation of the Sendai Framework for Disaster Risk Reduction, spanning from 2015 to 2030. And of course, to begin this plenary session, I first would like to introduce the session co-chairs, Professor Dilanthi Amarathunga, Global Disaster Resilience Center from the University of Huddersfield. She is joining us from the United Kingdom. The second co-chair, Mr. Sisida Manaperuma, Asian Disaster Preparedness Center. He will be joining us via virtual technology in Thailand. And also, finally, Dr. Ananda Malavaranthi, the country representative of IUCN Sri Lanka. Sir, stage is all yours.
Thank you very much. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. We are at the last stage of the 3-day symposium on multi-hazard early warning and disaster risk reduction, which was attended globally. Today, I am chairing this session with two other colleagues. They were introduced earlier, Professor Dilanthi Amarathunga, Professor of Disaster Risk Reduction, University of Huddersfield. And my other colleague is Mr. Sisida Manaperuma, Director, Preparedness for Response and Recovery, Asian Disaster Preparedness Center located in Bangkok, Thailand. And both Sisida and Dilanthi are joining through the system. And I was asked to do the honors of hosting it locally. It's a great pleasure to do it. And today we have a very special occasion of summing the full symposium, and also towards the end our chief guest will arrive. He is none other than Major General Retired GDH Kamal Gunaratne, Secretary of Defense and State Secretary for Ministry of National Security, Home Affairs and Disaster Management under the Disaster Management Center is functioning. So he will arrive at 6:15 sharp. So in between, we have a very fruitful session. To participate and enrich the session, we have an eminent panel with lot of experience. We have here in my left, Professor Ranj. I will start from the this corner. Professor Ranjit Disanayake. Professor Ranjit Disanayake is functioning as the secretary in the State Ministry of Rural Roads and Other Infrastructures, and he is also a senior professor of civil engineering, University of Peradeniya, Sri Lanka. And next we have Major General Sudhanta Ranasinghe, Director General of Disaster Management Center. And then we have Professor Ranjit Senaratne. He is functioning currently as the chairman of National Science Foundation of Sri Lanka. And then we are also joined by Dr. Hemanta Herath, Deputy Director General, Health Services of Ministry of Health, Sri Lanka. And all these gentlemen has lot of credentials, which I am not going to spend time, because they are known all over the world. So we will get straight into the technical area. And what we are intending to do in technical area is my two colleagues, Dilanthi and Sisira, they are having a certain questions already compiled from the questions came and collected throughout the symposium, and they will ask a few questions and they will we can follow up, and but we will be summing up exactly at 6:15 sharp for the arrival of the chief guest. So we have good more than half an hour. I think it's a good time. So without further ado, we will start the proceedings and the technical discussion. Then I will invite Professor Dilanthi Amarathunga and Mr. Sisira Madurapperuma to ask the questions. Then I will facilitate as it goes. Shall I start with Sisira, please?
Thank you, Dr. Arand. Very good afternoon from Bangkok, Thailand. We are very glad and honored that we got a distinguished panelist sit on the dais. I am sure that they will bring so much insight and knowledge to conclude this symposium. From what we have heard so far for the last 3 days during the symposium, we plan to go a little bit deeper into key issues and priorities that we would like to see embedded within DRR research policy and practice. To begin the discussions, maybe starting with Professor Dishanayake. Based on your extensive knowledge and practice with academia, as well as in the policy formulation processes within the government, what are the new knowledge that are required to tackle disaster risks, based on your extensive knowledge in disaster risk reductions as well as in academia? Over to you, sir.
Prof, can I just take a break? I had to apologize, and I, Professor Dias, I just missed you. My apologies. We have Professor Priyan Dias joining us through the internet. He's one of our gurus, so but still, apologies. Sorry, Professor.
Okay. Thank you for the questions. The new knowledge. Actually, we have been doing some work on the disaster risk reduction, especially on early warning. What we understand is the not only Sri Lanka, actually Myanmar, Thailand, as well as the Maldives and some other country. But our understanding is it doesn't matter what setup they have, but when they use the technology, they have come up with the barriers. Therefore, I think using the technology for the disaster risk reduction is a very important tool. Therefore, as a country, we must use the technology and the new knowledge into the practice. So that is where the key point is. When the new policy and the present government has been trying to embedded the disaster risk reduction as well as the sustainability into the practices. Even through our ministry also, when we develop the roads, networks and so forth, we always look into both aspects. One is the disaster risk reduction, other one is the sustainability. Because these become the two key areas where without that you cannot do the development. Therefore, I must say that the developing of the road network, we always think about the disaster risk reduction as well as sustainability. Why? Because of the roads are getting flooded and so many things are happening. So we have to think about it. Other way around, when we go to the development the road network like 100,000 kilometers, the material. So the material sustainability, usage of the new material and things are very important. Therefore, I must say that the present government is very keen on including of the disaster risk reduction and the sustainability into the practices. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Dishanayake. The second question is also coming from Sisira to Major General Sudhanta Ranasinghe. Sisira?
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Well, let's move to Major General Sudhanta Ranasinghe. You have been a champion in forming partnerships, not only during your last tenure with DMC, but throughout last 3 decades or so, if I put it that way. Tell us a little bit about, how should we form multi-sectoral partnerships, specifically to promote the whole society approach, taking into consideration of at-risk communities, based on your experience, based on your expertise, based on your work portfolio within the DMC. What are key messages that you like to enlighten us that how should we form multi-sectoral partnerships and collaborations? Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Sisara. It's 4 decades. And question of the connectivity, it's a mainstreaming with everybody. As Professor said about the road development also, if we don't mainstream with all the other connected organizations or connected other facilities, getting connected to the main project, then there is a disaster, because then after couple of days or the couple of months, you will find again new excavations and renovations coming in and new digging and so on and so forth. So it's mainstreaming of programs and getting connected with all stakeholders and all partners. If you don't mainstream, then there is a disconnect. In disaster management, you cannot have disconnects. So mainstreaming and reaching the vulnerable people, reaching the last person down the line. Then again, talking on the technology, as Professor said, again from the stakeholders and the professional organization, what we want is the capacity development and the capacity building. Maybe we have all the latest technologies, latest theories and latest system, but if we don't develop our capacities and the knowledge and the know-how, and then getting things connected into the rights of the people, where we have the responsibility of reaching and delivering the rights of the people, then there will be a disconnect. You shouldn't have disconnect. So mainstreaming, capacity development, reaching the people, respecting the rights of the people and delivering goods. That's what we want.
Thank you, Major General. Could you elaborate? You mentioned the right word, rights of people. Would you mind elaborating it?
Yes. Now, each and every organization has their own responsibilities towards the people, their targets or their mandates towards the people, and their responsibilities towards the people. Now, these responsibilities, mandates, and their targets of their own organization, the bottom line is reaching the people. That's a right to the person, right to individual. If you can't reach the right of the particular individual, you have failed as an organization. So most probably, most important thing is each and every department, each and every ministry, each and every organization must get connected and make sure that rights of the people are delivered. So we are in the disaster management center in 2021, we are planning to mainstream all organizations together, then all stakeholders getting connected with the responsible organization, ministries, the departments, and then have one connected wholesome plan where we have one national plan, where I'm sure Dr. Dhilanth will join us and help us with this program as well. And then we will have definitely take some time. That's okay. We have been waiting all these years, so it's better late than never. We make sure that we make one program reaching the rights of the people.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for the elaboration. Again, we have scheduled the questions coming from the same person just to keep the continuity. Sisira, again, the question is to Professor Priyandayas. Sisira.
Thank you so much, Ananda. In fact, my questions will go to Dr. Hera this time, and Professor Dhilanthi will discuss with Professor Priyandayas a little later.
Okay.
So let's move to Dr. Hera. Thank you so much, Dr. Hera, joining today's discussion. We all know how much you are busy during the middle of a pandemic. You know, thank you so much. Tell us a little bit about your views on the need to have an integrated approach, specifically supported by better communication on different types of hazards, including, you know, misconceptions about how slow onset biological hazards. You know, we have pandemics, but on the other hand, we have infodemics, right? With so much information. So there are a lot of misconceptions are there. So how would you propose us and all other stakeholders who are part of this community or this symposium to promote this integrated approach through better communications and avoiding some of these misconceptions? Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Sisira. I think this was one of the major challenges, not only in Sri Lanka, but in many parts of the world. This issue has been discussed, the infodemic or the communication issues that arise after following this pandemic. And in Sri Lanka also, we had the same issue, and it is something that, in my opinion, that was inevitable in the light of the current information technology, the social media, and the free availability of information from different sources, and the ability to publish information freely throughout the world, that is, which we did not have few decades ago probably. And now with the, especially the health authorities and also the other people who are engaged in risk communication especially, need to be geared to address this issue in an innovative ways, rather than trying to address it in a traditional and conventional ways, because the these scenarios are developing in a rapid way. Probably if you can quantify it, it is the rate of changing is going in exponential rates, rather than in a what I would say the word that I can use. So therefore, the not only the health authorities but all other people who are managing this information need to be well informed, and the data should be available in right time at the right place for communication, and then it should be communicated in a right manner, so that the people who are grasping it also need to be grasp that in a positive way. Because if the person who is producing or providing this information is providing that information in a threatening manner, if you don't do, we will be do this, we will be doing this. These are some of the things that people have taken it in a different way. We need to go through the minds of the people before making any kind of information that will be given to the people rightly, and we need to empathize. And then, because we know that several issues that have encountered in Sri Lanka, the when you address those issues in the right way, most of the people accept it and there are less rumors. But on the other hand, if you don't do it in that manner, large amount of overwhelming amount of information, misinformation is coming. So that would be the things that we need to keep in our mind and address the issue. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ayarath. We are so lucky to have you and to also to see you every day clarifying information in a very simplified manner. Very impressive. Now we are turned to Professor Dilanthi Amaratunga for the next three questions, and first questions to Professor Priyandayas. Dilanthi?
All right. Thank you very much, Ananda. Thank you very much for that. I suppose, you know, I'm just so privileged to be co-chairing this this panel with the panelists that we have, I think, coming from different dimensions and directions. So I think it is such a privilege. So Priyan, I suppose, you know, you are one of the most senior researchers and one of the most experienced academics in general, but in particular in disaster risk reduction area. So in that sense, I suppose, what do you see as kind of key opportunities for higher education and science in this scenario, bearing in mind what Major General said and what Professor Ranjit Dissanayake said about linking national to local policies and so on and so forth? So we need to actually look at this entire spectrum. So what is your view, Professor Dias, in terms of the role of higher education in that scenario?
Yes, well, there are two things that higher education does traditionally, no? One is the research, right? And the other one is the dissemination. So, yeah, both of these areas, I think, you know, higher education institutes all over the world are playing their role. And also, disaster risk reduction has got a reasonable focus. I would say that, I mean, especially if we look at engineering curricula worldwide through the International Engineering Alliance, I mean, they have an increasing focus on sustainability, right? The focus on disaster risk reduction is not so strongly spelled out. So, but if you think about it in another way, many people have tried to interpret disaster risk reduction as also an integral part of sustainability. So I think that is one way in which we can promote the goals of disaster risk reduction by in a sense, hitching a wagon to the sustainability discourse. Now, I know in engineering programs, sustainability is supposed to be one of the major outcomes, major program outcomes that are supposed to be done by all engineering programs. I'm sure, you know, these things are there in many other disciplines also. So that is one thing where the research is concerned. So the other thing, of course, is the communication and the teaching for the students, which I also described. Where the research is concerned, I think as the chairman DMC was saying that, you know, these linkages need to be there. I think we need to create linkages between research that is produced and actually implemented. So one way in which this can be done is through sort of, what shall I say, intermediate agencies. I mean, maybe not, you know, state departments who appear to be a bit far away from universities, but I'm just coining that word, you know, the National Building Research Organization, Disaster Management Center. They are agencies that are fairly close to university academics and frequently call upon university academics and probably have databases of university academics so you will have those kinds of organizations all over the world, and I think they would serve as kind of linkages between sort of state policy and research done by university academics. I'll stop there.
Professor, can I if I follow up? I think the DMC, the NBRO, and the Med Department, and that likes irrigation, they are converted. Now, in the university, you have the luxury to sensitize and mainstream some of these risk reduction ideas to the whole student community. What is your view about it? How should we go about doing it?
Yes, so like I said now, the other thing is, of course, these things take time a bit. So, I mean, sustainability now has really come into engineering curricula. If at all, I think disaster risk reduction has come. It has not come really, in my opinion, other than for sort of very specific programs on this, right? There are very specific programs, especially at master's level. But I think, like I said earlier, my feeling is that we should link these DRR concepts to the sustainability discourse. Apart from that, of course, disaster risk reduction gets covered as application areas in many things. So whether it is data analytics or whether it is transport systems or whatever it is, disaster risk reduction scenarios are often covered in that way. But at the moment, there is no banner saying disaster risk reduction. Sustainability has achieved that. I'm just saying strategically and tactically how we should approach it, right? So that is my view. Yeah.
Thank you, Professor Priyandayas. Next, we turn again. The question is coming from Dilanti. The question is to Professor Ranjit Senaratne.
Thank you very much, Anand. Again, Professor Ranjit Senaratne. So, of course, I don't think that you need any more introduction. So, you are actually heading the National Science Foundation of Sri Lanka, which is actually a premier national institution in the country, mandated to promote research and development and scientific literacy for the well-being of people in the country. So, in that sense, what is your view about capacity building of the society in promoting research and research creating links between science, policy, and practice? I think Professor Dias actually touched based on that, and also I think all these issues are very much interlinked. Actually, Ranjit, for example, Major General emphasized the point that importance of local communities and translating the message from national to local. So likewise, I suppose, what is your view actually, Ranjit, in terms of promoting this broader view as the chairperson of National Science Foundation?
Okay, thank you, Dilanti. Now this capacity building and disaster risk reduction. Now, Sri Lanka was considered country free of disasters until tsunami struck us. And then we have been having, especially with the advent of climate change, frequent drought, floods, even cyclones, and also a few landslides. And if we look at the response, it has been more reactive and relief-centric rather than aimed at reducing risk and also mitigation, building recovery mechanism and so on. So our country has been really not responding in terms of research to this. That has been relatively underdeveloped compared to many other sectors. But we see now the frequency, intensity, ferocity and magnitude of disasters actually increasing at an increasing rate. So there should be a paradigm shift from relief base to a reactive mode to proactive mode. So in this connection, the capacity building in research is of course a high priority concern. But in Sri Lanka, compared to several other fields, there's a dearth of experience personnel in Sri Lanka. Actually, with the intervention of Dilanti, we see now there is a lot of interest universities are involved, but also in regard to equipment and infrastructure required to carry out necessary research, there is again a constraint. So NSF, in fact, really accorded high priority to this field of research and also capacity building, including enhancement of infrastructure facilities. So we have developed a database of all high-end equipment available so that they could be effectively mobilized to address high priority concerns by way of research. Now, when we look at the issue of disaster, we know it is multifaceted, multidimensional, cutting across many sectors, many strata in society. So we need to have the national level and district or provincial level and also local level. There are several institutions involved. All have to work in concert as an inclusive and cohesive ecosystem. Then only we can really tackle this problem and minimize really risk associated disaster. Here especially, now we have been talking about literacy, also IT literacy. We have literacy about 95% and IT literacy, I think, is about 30. But we got disaster literacy. I think that area that needs attention. I think we need to make our people, community, disaster literate. Especially now we have this VIDA, the centers about over 230, and National Science Foundation tried to mobilize these centers to really have a community program, community awareness, community empowerment program, so that they could be made more disaster literate. So in the event of hazard, we could reduce the impact on the community, the people and the property through this improvement of disaster literacy. This is briefly my response, Dilanti.
Thank you so much, Professor. Dilanti, do you have any follow-up questions?
No, I just want to sort of say that, you know, what Ranjit actually mentioned really sort of marries up very well with what other panelists said also, Anand. I suppose this concept about disaster literacy is very, very good. And I think it fits in really well with Major General's ambitions about educating and capacity building at the community level. So I suppose, you know, they both are sitting next to each other. So I'm sure a big collaboration will be formed then and there. So thank you very much.
Dilanti, just a follow-up question to you. Now, for the last 10 years or more, you have been coming to Sri Lanka and trying to get the universities and others to work together. And this one aspect we were trying hard is like who is doing what and where in the research front, in the action front. Now, I think you have several projects you have mobilized very recently to support that. I think yesterday Professor Champa Navaratna was highlighting some of them. Would you mind shedding, like take a minute and shedding some light on from that angle?
I suppose, you know, you raised a very valid question, Ananda, in terms of identifying who is doing what. I think that is really, really important. Again, I think I will link that to NSF, actually. I think Ranjit will add more information because I'm aware that he's actually promoting a platform in collecting that exactly very same information. So I think that platform will provide very good information about understanding who's doing what. I think that is really, really important, bringing all these stakeholders together to understand what the wider problem is and what the solutions are very, very important, Ananda. And also in that sense, from the Association of Disaster Management Professionals, I know that which you are leading. I think that is also a very, very good platform to pick up that information and to bring all these stakeholders together. So really speaking, I think that will be a really, really good initiative for us to do in terms of linking these pieces in this jigsaw puzzle and to see what the gaps are. So, I'm very much open to any initiatives, and, you know, we should be able to mobilize resources also. And I'm just looking at Sisira. I'm sure he will be able to help us as well. So I think let's take that idea and then take it forward, Ananda. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dilanti. Actually, thank you for highlighting it, and thank you, Professor Senaratna, for offering the NSF platform to work with the DMC on that. And also in our audience, we have Mr. Hashim, who had been working with private sector quite a bit. I mean, that's another aspect that we can probably make these linkages fairly strong. So, Dilanti, you had the last question.
I suppose I'm a bit conscious about the time, actually.
Okay. You can go one question.
We have, but I suppose I had a discussion with Sisira. Perhaps I think wearing his intergovernmental organization hat and also with his portfolio, perhaps I think he fits in better to ask that question on the policy front. So over to you, Sisira, on that.
Thanks, Dilanti. Thank you again, Sisira.
Yeah, thank you so much, Professor Dilanti and Dr. Anand. So I have a bit of open-ended questions, and I'm just putting to the panel, anyone can pick that questions and answer, or maybe a couple of them can answer, or all of them can answer as well. So by looking at some of the recent government development policies and programs, you know, one of the eye-catching thing is basically Vistas of Prosperity and Spend, which His Excellency the President has been, taking over and then promoting across the sectors and across the board. So my question to the panel is that, you know, how would you see disaster risk reduction is embedded within the overall government policies such as Vistas of Prosperity and Splendor, or maybe sectoral development policies and strategies? Now, Professor Dishanayake is leading one of the infrastructure ministry, and then also we got the Secretary of Minister of Education and so on. So if any one of you, you can take these questions, or maybe a couple of you can take these questions and highlight or enlighten us about that.
I propose Major General, because Major General put his hand on developing the next 5-6 years program in Sri Lanka. That will, I think I'll let Major to go.
Thank you, sir. Good question. We started with developing our next 10-year strategy and next 5-year action plan with the professionals of disaster management led by Anand. And we have been working on that for last couple of months rather. Of course, we had physical interaction, and then of course we had to go to virtual also, but we have been meeting. So what I did was I got, if I may use the word, all the old hands and the professionals together under one platform, as Dilanti mentioned, with Dr. Ananda, and we have been sitting together. And we are developing our DRR next strategy for next 21 to 30 based on 4 principles of Sendai framework and 7 targets. And on that scenario, we are developing our strategy, scientific and technical way, and we are developing and transforming it to next 5 years action plan. So that action plan, with that action plan, we are getting connected all the other agencies like NBRO, MET, we have Director General CS sitting right in front of me, and the irrigation, and all the stakeholders are getting connected. We have already developed the first draft to important partners, so I'm waiting for that, and once that comes through and before 31st, my target is 31st December, before 31st December, we will be releasing the strategy for 2021-30 and action plan 2021-25 and the NEOP as well as other internal administrative documents all as well with lot of collaboration and coordination with all professionals in the subject.
Thank you.
And of course, Splendor of Vistas is the number one consideration in that. Sorry, I missed that word.
Okay. Any other panelists want?
Yeah, I would like to add a little bit. With the development plan taking place, that we, with the help of the Green Building Council of Sri Lanka, and we have been incorporating the sustainability into the road development, city development, and construction and so forth. But what they are, we have been helping through the Green Building Council of Sri Lanka, where I am the chairman. So, but recently, with the help of Dilanthi and all that, we converted all this application with the incorporation of sustainability. So, for example, when the city development, of course, we have to go for the greener city development and so forth, but it doesn't survive without the DRR concept. Therefore, we converted all the applications or the all the procedures where the disaster risk reduction will be taken care. So that presently the most of the development that we plan, and the it may be city development, it may be road development or whatever, we have incorporated the disaster risk reduction. At the beginning we started actually with the only with the sustainability, but now during last 1 year, like, we have converted the, what the rating tool, everything into the disaster risk reduction. Therefore I can say that the now the present development is not only sustainability but also disaster risk reduction has been embedded into that one. I don't want to go into the detail of one by one how it is done. Basically across the development we do, because the SVO, I am in the state ministry of rural roads and other infrastructure, but we have a linkage with the other ministry, like we work with the Ministry of Environment for the program, like what they have in the sustainability side, and we work with the area of like urban development, so that we have a kind of network developed within the government setup where we share the knowledge and the application. If I can correctly say that the, not only sustainability but also DRR being well recognized by the present government and the, their application process. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Dissanayake. Hemant, do you want to add?
I think now we know that all this, why we bother about disaster management, basically predominantly because humans are affected. They may be affected physically, maybe mentally, maybe socially, maybe economically. Whatever the thing, finally health comes into the field. And as a result, I think the paradigm shift that Professor Senaratna talked about was we initiated really after the tsunami, and we started our activities related to the disaster risk reduction in the health sector after tsunami, and we had our two strategic plans. Now we are in the in preparation of the third strategic plan, and we now the health sector disaster management has become part and parcel of the national health development, and that will be again more and more applied, and more and more people will be used in the health sector rather than waiting for a disaster. They all now try to incorporate the disaster management into the system. So I think that has happened, and I probably think that that will be more and more evident in the coming years.
Thank you, Dr. Herath. Professor?
Briefly add, now whatever you do, there's risk involved. So we have to minimize risk in order to achieve success. But with the advent of climate change and also because of anthropogenic impact, you see there is now greater impact, greater risk to achieve success. So we need to assess that and also minimize, especially now disaster risk reduction here assumes considerable importance. So it should be a common thread running through all activities of all sectors, and if you disregard this factor, you will actually be ending up with another disaster. So I think this should be an integral part of each and every activity. So it should be embedded into each and every activity and program.
Thank you so much. I think we heard a lot. I think that provide us a nice summation of the symposium messages as well. So with that, I would like to thank our panel, Professor Ranjit Dishanayake, Major General Sudhantha Rana Singha, Professor Priyan Dias, my apologies again, sir, Professor Ranjit Senaratne, and our two co-chairs, my colleagues, Sisira Madhura Peruma and Professor Dilanti Amaratunga. With that, we are hoping the chief guest is on the way. So we will wind the session now. Thank you so much. And just wait till, I think you can please go ahead. Oh, shall we? You can go and take seats, and I think they are going to rearrange a little bit here.
Sri Lanka, a tropical island with a heritage of a vibrant history, culture, and enchanting beauty. Spread across nearly 65,000 square kilometers with a multi-religious, multilingual, and multi-ethnic population of 21.4 million people. It is administratively divided into 9 provinces, 25 districts, which are divided into divisional secretariats. Each divisional secretariat is composed of several Gramaniladhari divisions. Sri Lanka is prone to Natural and Man Management Act No. 13 of 2005, gating risks.